You're watching. Yeah, Brendan's in the car.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Glad you're here today. I'm Pastor Eric Young. On behalf of our church staff and our church council, we're glad you're here. If there's anything you need, please reach out to any one of us. We'll do our best to help out. Some announcements as we start our time together. Our CDC, Child Development Center, they have openings available for school age before and after school spots. So if you know someone in need who could use that before and after school care, please reach out to our Child Development Center. They'll be happy to talk to those folk. Next slide. Our food pantry is collecting all sorts of food, but the ones they're looking for specifically this month in October is diced tomatoes, canned fruit, and pancake mix. No, we're not mixing them all together. But we are accepted. Those are the items they are looking to collect this month. But Pastor, I wanted to bring green beans. Please do. I want to bring rice. Please do. We're collecting all sorts of food items. Little box in the back there that goes to our food pantry. But these are the specific items they're hoping you will get additionally. Now, the easiest way to do this is on your shopping list. The very first thing on your shopping list, just write food pantry. And that way when you're out at the grocery store, you'll go, oh, I'll grab this as well for the food pantry. So we are collecting all sorts of items, but specifically this month, we are looking for those three things in particular. Next slide. Today begins our 4/5 club for the school year. 4/5 club, what's that? Well, that's 4th and 5th graders, your youth group. So that starts today after church. We're going to meet in the youth room and go till 11:30. It goes from 10:30 to 11:30. So you got some free time to play the video games in there or the foosball, stuff like that. So come be part of that with us. If you got questions, please see Miss Bridget. She will tell you all about it. Tomorrow. It's already next week, sorry. Tomorrow is Breakfast Club. It is 8:30 at Perkins on Peach Street. What do you need to do to be part of Breakfast Club? Show up. Literally is a group of people who get together on the first Monday of the month at Perkins. They have breakfast together, and they just are present with one another. That right there, it's a great time. So just show on up, be present, have some breakfast with church outside of this building. Next slide. We are in need of candy donations for Trunk or Treat. Don't worry, I will sample to make sure they're all okay. But if you're not going to have a trunk as part of our Trunk or Treat, please go ahead and bring in candy donations. We are looking for that to collect, because last year, I believe we had 300 kids. So that's a whole lot of candy for trunks. So we do accept donations if that's something you would like to do. More on the Trunk or Treat in a little bit. Next slide. Youth group, our confirmation youth group begins next Sunday. So confirmation, we began with our crop walk. And then we're going to actually have our confirmation class beginning this next Sunday. It'll be every second and fourth Sunday. So we look forward to having your confirmands as part of our group starting next Sunday. We'll meet in the youth room and go till noon. Next slide. If you're looking for something for the first through third graders to do, we have a brand new kids club happening. It is on the third Monday of every month from 6:30 to 8 p.m., and I believe it's not just kids, it's families as well, or is it just kids? I'm not quite sure how that's working. At this point, it's just kids, okay. But that's also the same night council is, and there's no guarantee that council is going to show up at council when you got kids club happening. So we'll see how much fun they're having versus us. So that is the third Monday of the month from 6:30 to 8 p.m. It's in the gym and the youth room, so we invite your first through third graders to be part of that with us. Next slide, fall garden cleanup. That is the last Saturday of this month, so that's the 26th. Starting at 9 in the morning and going to 1. And we're going to just clean up the churchyards, get it ready for winter. So we do encourage you to come on out with your tools, be present, and help us get our property ready for the closing of the growing season. Also, that same day, next slide, is our trunk or treat. But it starts with a Halloween fall carnival that we're having in the gym, going from 6 to 7 o'clock. So we invite you to come be part of that with us. What we're going to do is we're going to invite all the families that are showing up to come in and do these crafts, these games, be present in this space with us. And at 7 o'clock, you'll launch them out so they can go trunk or treat in the safety of our parking lot. Come be part of our community on that day. Next slide is just a reminder that we have tons of other things going on at our church. We have the dates for the Thanksgiving feast and worship happening. They're up there. We have all sorts of things, including different committees. Like Tuesday night is our faith formation committee. So if you're part of that committee, we'll see you at 5:30. But all that information is up there on our webpage and on our Facebook. Please go and peruse that stuff and look at all the things that your church is doing for your church and the surrounding community. Also, for those of you joining us from home, we're glad you're here with us today. Please feel free to share the peace via text when the time comes. I do believe those are our announcements for this morning. I do invite you at this moment to quiet your hearts, quiet your minds, and transition from getting here to being here. I invite you to stand as we begin our worship in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will, walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Worship and praise, let us
us pray together. Sovereign God, you have created us to live in loving community with one another. Form us for life that is thoughtful and steadfast, and teach us to trust like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
It's time for Children's Church, boys and girls.
I've got the joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I got the joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart.
Let us now hear the word of God through our holy scriptures. Our first reading today is from the third chapter of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to sow. A time to keep silence, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. The word of the Lord. Our second reading is from Hebrews, beginning with the first chapter. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom he has also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we are speaking, to angels, but someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet." Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing to outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of this congregation, I will praise you." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked him, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. I know the gospel is intriguing in what it talks about, but we're not spending any time on that at all today. Matter of fact, our preaching text is the first lesson. But just so you know what the gospel says, it doesn't say what you think it means. So, if you got questions, come talk to me about it. But let's talk about the first lesson. Years ago, I was driving through Los Angeles, and if you know what that means, it means you were stuck in traffic. And so you're sitting there, and you got no one to keep you company except your radio. So I'm listening to the radio, and the DJ comes on and just starts talking like DJs do. And he says, "I had this really eye-opening experience this weekend. I went to see my dad like I do a lot of different weekends, and it was Saturday. Went to visit him at the house that I grew up in, and you know, we're there and we're talking, and we walk out to the garage, and my dad's tinkering around in the garage, and then he walks over to this plastic pretzel jar, you know the one I'm talking about, but there aren't pretzels in there. Instead, there are marbles. And I watch my dad walk over, open it up, take out a marble, look at the marble, and drop it into the trash can. I literally am watching my dad lose his marbles. And I'm wondering about this, and I'm trying to think about which homes would be best for him at this point. And I just asked, "Dad, what are you doing?" He goes, "Oh, it's something I've been doing for a couple years now. I researched it. The average American male lives to 75. And I'm 64 right now, and so I started doing some math about how much time the average American male has left at this age. And I realized that if I'm average, from this point on, I got about 11 years left, and there's 52 weeks in a year. And so a couple years ago, I did all that math, and I dumped like 780 marbles into here, because that's about how much time I had left. And if my math is correct, I'm down to somewhere under 600 marbles. And what I do every week on Saturday is I take a marble out and I look at it, because it represents the week that I just had. Did I use it well? Or did I waste it? It doesn't matter what the answer is, because no matter what, that marble is now gone. But maybe if I didn't spend the attention that I needed to this past week, maybe this marble will help me make more of this next week. Because the reality is, I don't know how much time I have left. I don't know if I'm going to get through all these marbles or if I should have put another 200, 300 marbles in here. But what I do know is I have this marble right now. What am I doing with it? And this DJ talked about how this opened his eyes, and he realized that his dad was not being morbid or doing something that was like, "Oh my goodness, this just wigs me out." But he made sense of something. We have this week. What am I going to do with the week that I have? Pretty interesting way to look at things, isn't it? to look at the life you have. How did you use this past week? If you're to spend some time right now and do an assessment on your week, how did you spend that week? Was it a wasted marble, or was it a marble that was well used? I'm going to guess that very few of us in this room until this very moment assessed this past week. True statement? Hadn't really thought about it. We just had the week and we're on to the next one already. But we really should do an accounting for ourselves, shouldn't we? We should look at that week, at that time that we've been given, and see what we've done with it. So, let me ask you, as you think about this, how did you spend your average day last week? Slide, please. From Business Insider, if you were doing an average week of the average American, this is what your week would break down to. I know it's a bit of an eye chart for you, so I'll just spend some time here. So out of your 24 hours in a day, your average day was spent like this. The biggest one up there, sleeping, 8.8 hours. Folks, I don't know who they interviewed, but I don't know anyone who gets 8.8 hours of sleep in a day. If you do, please come talk to me, because I would like to know what that's like. With 8.8 hours are spent sleeping. Now you go to the next thing, and that's work, working and work-related activities. The average person works about 8 hours, but during that time, you only spend 3.5 hours working. Seems about right, right? The next thing down, you got just under 3 hours of the average person watching television. Football game, TV show, binge-watching something on Netflix or Hulu, right? The next thing down, under 2 hours, you got about 1 hour and 45 minutes spent in household activities. And then you get down to 90 minutes of other leisure. I don't know what they consider household activities and other leisure, but I don't equate those two. But you spend 1.5 hours doing leisure, and then eating and drinking, about 1 hour and 15 minutes in a day. You get down to personal care, taking care of yourself. Showering, putting on makeup, taking off makeup, showering again. You're looking at about 45 minutes. Same with purchasing goods and services. Maybe run to the grocery store, maybe go out and get some shoes. But that's about 45 minutes of your day. And then you spend a little bit less than that socializing and communicating. Get down to about 30 minutes of your day is spent taking care of household members. If you got kids, it's a whole lot more than that, or aging parents, you probably have a lot more than that. If you got your kids out of the house, your parents are doing just fine, it's probably less than that. Congratulations to you. We get down to under 1/2 hour spent on educational activities. We spend less time getting smarter in a day than we do watching TV. Let that sink in for a bit. Get down to organizational and civic activities, about 20 minutes a day. Other activities not classified elsewhere, also about 20 minutes a day. Sports and exercise and recreation. You spend about 15 minutes a day doing that. Folks, if you want to be a healthy human being, you better spend more than 15 minutes moving and doing exercise. Will all my medical professionals agree with that? All right. Get down to caring and helping non-household members, about 10 minutes of your day, helping someone else who's not living in your house. And then you spend about 5 to 10 minutes on telephone calls, email, and mail. That's how the average American spends a day. If you do an accounting, how would your day look? How would you spend your day? You can go to the next slide, which is back to the sermon slide. Time matters, and how you spend that time matters. Why am I bringing this up? Because we are starting a sermon series on stewardship. Now, before you grab your air sickness bag from your pew rack, I'm not going to sit up here and tell you, oh, you need to give more money. That's not the point of these next 3 weeks. These next 3 weeks, we're going to spend time talking about time, talents, and possessions. And this week, you can see that we're talking about time. because every single Sunday we bring an offering plate forward. And we say a prayer that says, God, we thank you for giving us what you have so graciously given, ourselves, our time, our possessions, signs of your gracious love. We've been saying this as Lutherans since 1974, when the LBW was created, 78 when it came out, but this prayer has not changed. Signs of your gracious love, our time, our talents, our possessions. We're going to talk about what it means to give our time, our talents, our possessions, why we give those things. Well, first and foremost, it's not ours to hold on to. But in order to talk about stewardship, we better define it, don't you think? Stewardship, to be a steward of something. Yes, we use the word in the definition. So let's get down to the word steward. The word steward literally means to be the caretaker of someone else's stuff. Your time is not your time. It is God's. You are a steward of the time that God has so graciously shared with you. What's that mean, to be a steward of that time? Well, number one, it's to be aware of how we're spending it. But let's look at our first reading that Jim read for us. Now, you all recognize this, right? If you're my age or older, who did not have the Birds song going through your head? To everything, turn. Here's the lyrics, straight from King Solomon, which I bet they didn't share their royalties with him. For everything there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven. Time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to sow, a time to mourn, a time to dance, a time to tear, and a time to sew together. Folks, you're seeing both ends of the teeter-totter here, right? You got both ends. But what are we missing? Everything in the middle. There's a poem called The Dash. And if you've not read the poem, I invite you to Google it when you get home today. The Dash. It's about a gravestone. About this gravestone has the day that the person's born and the day that they died. What mattered was the dash. How did you spend your dash? Because that's where you currently are, folks. You're at the in-between times. The times that are defining why your birth mattered and why the loss of you mattered. It's that dash that counts. It's that time in between. Now, as a pastor, I've been ordained for 28 years, so pastoring for 28 years, but I've been a professional church worker for 34. And in that time, I've had lots of opportunity, lots of blessing to be at someone's bedside as they prepared to die, as they breathe their last, as they talk to me, as they're in the final days of hospice. Folks, in all that time, I've never once heard someone say, "Oh, Pastor, I wish I would have spent more time in the office." I'm sure you can ask Pastor Beth if she agrees with that, and Pastor Mark when he gets here. I don't think any of us pastors have ever heard anyone ever say, "Oh, I should have spent more time in the office." Almost always, it is just the opposite. Where have you spent your dash, the dash that God has so graciously given you? Now, that being said, you should have a job. You should spend time in the office because you have a certain set of gifts that the world needs. And we're going to talk about that when we get to the talents section next week. And then we'll follow up with the money that's made from that job that supplies your daily needs. The opportunity to go and explore the world and thrive and put food on the table. We'll talk about that in the possessions time 2 weeks from now. You should have a job, but it should know its place. How should you be spending your time? I know the good church answer, Pastor. I should be in church. You know that 1 hour a week you show up to listen to a guy in a dress talk? to listen to music on an instrument that no one knows how to play anymore, except for maybe one person. Let me color this for you. Church just doesn't happen in this space. This is an important time for us. We do gather here once a week as a community of faith so we can go out and be a community of faith outside this place. This is sacred time. But this is not where we go punch our little time card so God, look God, I did my 1 hour out of the 168 for you. No, all 168 are God's. What are you doing with it? Well, we come here, use my favorite analogy for this. This is our gas station. We show up here as a community of faith to fill our tanks and to fill other people's tanks so we can go out from here to do all the things that God would have us do in the world for the rest of the 167 hours of the week. That's why we're here, to be a community of faith in this place so we can be a community of faith out of this place. So, Pastor, should I be, like, doing churchy things everywhere at all hours of the day? You're missing the community of faith part. Part of that is filling your own tanks and experiencing God in all the areas of the world. Folks, I'll tell you, sitting on your kayak watching the sunset is not a waste of your time. Going down, taking a drive around Presque Isle is not a waste of your time. Sitting in the quiet by a fire pit is not a waste of your time. It is a good use of your time where you get to be present in God's presence. Yes, that's good use of your time, but that's not the only place we use it. We use it when we go out and we see someone who needs our help. We go out and share our time with them because it is God's time to share. So, if we go on to verse 9, what gain do workers have in their toil? I've seen the business that God has given to them, to everyone to be busy with. Okay, you're supposed to have a job. It's good, but that's not where you live. Going on, God's made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, the sense of past and future into their minds. Okay, folks, we understand that what's gone is gone. The time that is in our past is memory, and we can't read the future. God has made sure that we understand this. I know that there's nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they shall live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all people should eat, drink, and take pleasure in their toil. There's joy to be found in this life, in this world. Eat, enjoy the food on the table, and share that food with others. Drink. There is absolutely nothing wrong with going out with the girls on a Thursday night and sharing a bottle of wine. There's something sacred in that, according to this text. It's where you're supposed to be. But that time, the time that you have isn't just yours, it is other people's, as I started to say. Folks, if you go into my office, you're going to see it set up in a certain way. Yes, it's a mess, I'm sorry. You're going to see it set up in a certain way. I got this bank of couches, and my desk is there facing out the window, but that's not why my desk is facing out the window. Because I figured something out a few years too late. We were at Synod Assembly in Southern California, and there was this panel that was brought in of thriving churches that weren't Lutheran. And one of the guys who was in was an Episcopal pastor who was there talking about his church. It was full of 20, 30, and 40-somethings. They were just growing and thriving, and the questions being asked of him were, okay, what program did you get? I mean, did you get it from, like, Augsburg or some other house? What are you doing study-wise? Where'd you get that? And he goes, stop. You all are looking for lightning in a bottle. You're looking for the magic serum that you can buy somewhere. You're looking for the newest, greatest church program, and you're missing the whole point. The people are the program. Folks, the light bulbs that went on around that room were just blinding. The people are the program. I have my desk set up that way because early in my ministry, I was very focused on getting ministry done. Okay, I got to get this lesson plan put together for youth group. Oh, wait, I'm writing my sermon here. I got these phone calls to make, and I got this email to send, and someone comes in, and it was an interruption. And at some point, I figured out that's the reason I'm here. Not this desk, not this computer. So the reason my desk is set up that way is not so I can look out our window at our beautiful parking lot. It's because that way when you come in, I turn away from all that other distraction to focus on what really matters. You. Folks, there are people that you are going to give to who are going to give back. And they're going to fill you in the same way that you fill them. But there's other people that you're going to pour your time into that can't give anything back to you. Guess what? It's not your time to waste on them. It's God's time to invest in them, because at that point, once you invest in them, that time can go out to other people through them. And in case you didn't know this, there are people who have dumped time into you that you're never going to pay back. And that's okay. You see, the time that we've been given, that dash, that short time that we're on this planet, well, it's made to invest in God's kingdom. And the people sitting around you, and the people you will meet out in this world outside these doors, are God's kingdom. Invest God's time well. Spend that time in them and with them. Look at God's creation and say, God, you are amazing. And come here, refill your tanks and fill other people's tanks so you can go out and change the world. Enjoy the time that you've been given. It is a gift of God. May we use that time well. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Church, let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of your Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints.
You're invited to stand, sit, or kneel as is your tradition for prayer.
Challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. God of our ancestors, we give thanks for the church in all times. May we listen for the prophets of this age who bear messages that stir the church toward the renewal and justice. God of grace, hear our prayer. Creator of every creature on earth, direct our lives toward the renewal and sustaining of cattle, birds of the air, animals of the field, and those who share our homes. Reveal the ways we can work alongside creation for the health and well-being of all. God of grace, hear our prayer. Sovereign God, we give thanks that you are mindful and benevolent to even us, mere mortals. Accompany us when hardness of heart gets in the way of justice between people and nations. Endow leaders with minds for justice and hearts for compassion. God of grace. Restoring Lord, grant healing and wholeness to those who are sick and suffering, especially Ann Anderson, Vince Belinsky, Janet Sear, Emma Cunningham, Lee Amy, Gail Elmer, Debbie and Ted Ferment, Mark and Vicki Fisher, Lois Gilbert, Marcia Grace, Charlotte Haggerty, Phyllis Kennedy, Karen Laufer, Richard McGarvey, Pastor Mack, Jim and Nancy Price, Len Toy, Russ Wiest, Gary, our homebound members and friends of St. Paul's, Michael Andrews, Fred Beckwith, Pam Bittens, Nathan Chun, Laura Danielson, Brenda Dolwick, Julie Fike, Betty Fry, Christopher Gleckler, Sue Hart, Ron King, Mary Lyons, Dana Martinez, Tom Matthew, Joyce and Liz Morshauser, Chip Roward, Chris Saltonstall, Mary Kay Scott, Maria Seifert, Lee Schwartzfeger, Thomas Tell, Keith Visconti, Carol, Rob, and for those we name aloud and in our hearts.
Victims of the hurricane.
Work through medical professionals to diagnose, ease pain, and give life to all who seek their wisdom and experience. God of grace, hear our prayer. Unifying God, humans were created for relationship with the earth, its creatures, and one another. Forgive us when division threatens companionship, mutual support, and unity among us. May your love inspire us to build supportive communities of faith where all are cherished. God of grace, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give both now and forever.
Amen.
Peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
I mean, I...
Let us pray together. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy.
Jesus, the one who spent his time with his people, was gathered with his disciples the night in which he was betrayed. There at supper he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Every time you eat bread, every time, remember me." After supper he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you. It's a new covenant for the forgiveness of all your sins. Every time you drink wine, every time, remember me." We remember our Lord in the bread, the wine, and the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
You may be seated for a few instructions. All are welcome to God's table. When you come, we invite you to come down the center aisle. If you're coming from this side, start here in the middle and go out toward that end. If you're coming from this side, come down and start over near the choir loft and fill into the middle. We have both bread and a gluten-free option. If you need the gluten-free option, please just ask. We also have both wine and a non-alcoholic grape juice. As you need. All are welcome to God's table. Come and eat.
Oh, how could it be that my God would welcome me into this mystery? Say, take my bread, take this wine, now the simple may for anyone to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you. And remembrance leads us to worship. And as we faithful, Lord, we remember. to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restore. Submission, always at rest.
I invite you to stand for the blessing. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray together. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord goes before you and is with you. The Lord will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Holding on to this promise, we go out into the world for the sake of the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Has ended. Now our service begins. Go in peace. Christ is sending you.
Thanks be to God.